9/5 for transmission on the 10th of the 7th, 77. Part 1, take 1.
Live in the most secretive country in the world. You live in the country where government by profession is the biggest cover-up there's ever been.
Politics on television is normally seen from outside. Politicians come into television studios when they want to persuade us that what they're doing is right.
My lords, pray be seated.
They let us in for purely formal occasions, but when the real decisions are taken, the door is firmly shut. This series takes you inside British politics. Today in this room, you can see an unusual event, a reconstruction of how ministers split and argued over a major policy decision that took place in cabinet. Cabinet discussions are secret, even years after a decision, when ministers' memoirs and the cabinet minutes are published, the information about who argued what around the cabinet table is sketchy and partial. But in 1976, the economic crisis produced such intense disagreements that there were leaks in the press which provided the State of the Nation programme with the opportunity to present a unique, many-sided account of what happened when the Cabinet took its biggest decision of the year. Should it accept the terms of a massive loan from the IMF?
A year ago, the pound started falling sharply. To save sterling, the government arranged a huge international rescue operation. The left were angered by the package of spending cuts which followed in July. But soon the pound started to slide again. Then on September the 28th, when the Chancellor of the Exchequer, Dennis Healey, had got as far as London Airport about to fly abroad, he heard the pound had dropped 2 cents in an hour. He turned round, having telephoned the Treasury and the Prime Minister, got back into his car and returned to Whitehall. The next day, he applied to the International Monetary Fund for the biggest loan it has ever been asked for. But it was when ministers thought about the conditions they would have to accept to get this loan that the cabinet argument started. The 8 journalists in this programme are able to reconstruct the arguments because the controversy in cabinet became so intense it broke through the normal rules of cabinet secrecy. The kind of arguments that were used by the Prime Minister are put by David Watt, political editor of the Financial Times. Hugh Stevenson, editor of the Times Business News, puts arguments of Dennis Healey, Chancellor of the Exchequer. Peter Jenkins, political columnist of The Guardian, puts arguments of Anthony Crossland, the Foreign Secretary. Adam Raphael, political correspondent of The Observer, puts arguments of Harold Lever, Chancellor of the Duchy of Lancaster. Ian Aitken, political editor of The Guardian, puts arguments of Peter Shaw, Secretary of State for the Environment. Michael Hatfield, of the political staff of the Times, puts arguments of David Ennals, the Secretary of State for Social Services. Richard Clements, editor of Tribune, puts arguments of Tony Benn, Secretary of State for Energy. And Peter Riddle, economics correspondent of the Financial Times, puts arguments of Roy Hattersley, Secretary of State for Prices and Consumer Protection. Between them, these journalists wrote many of the best informed articles about the cabinet conflict. Each of them draws his information from many sources, particularly ministers and senior civil servants. For this programme, they've combined all their information. Details have been checked and cross-checked to agree an account which they think is more full and accurate than any yet published. This programme is not a word-by-word account of what went on, and the journalists don't necessarily agree with the ministers whose arguments they put. They're presenting, in their own words, in 1 hour, the kind of arguments ministers used in and around the cabinet in 6 weeks of conflict over the loan.
Well, the first item today is the question of our application for a drawing from the International Monetary Fund, which we made on the 29th of September. I understand the IMF team's arrived. Perhaps the Chancellor would like to fill us in on the timetable.
Certainly. We've been getting down to serious consultation with the IMF. The head of the IMF mission, Mr. Whittam, called on me this morning. Our first job, obviously, is to review and refine our own forecasts and then to get down to the job of interpreting them with the IMF and then with the IMF finally moving towards some sort of policy recommendation. Now, since July, I'm bound to say that our forecasts have been causing us some difficulty. Our best guess at the moment is that the deficit next year will be just under 11 billion, which is about 2 billion worse than we were forecasting in July.
I don't know how we're supposed to deal with these very difficult economic questions, to say nothing of the political questions, when the Treasury is putting out stuff that changes every 2 weeks, and you never know whether it's a pious hope or a realistic projection.
I wish it was only every few weeks. When the Treasury do change their forecasts, they don't even get them right. So the problem we face, really, as I see it, is that we don't know where we are. No wonder the IMF are suspicious. But, of course, worse is if we're forced by some inaccurate forecasting into totally unnecessary measures.
You could always try kicking the computer.
Well, kick the Treasury.
We could be a little more serious. What I'm trying to get across to you is that, although it is very early days yet, we have to face the fact that the IMF is bound to think that a lower deficit would be appropriate for us in our present situation, and that if we are going to produce now a comprehensive package which will carry conviction and restore confidence, we shall almost certainly have to take action that will be painful and difficult.
It would be quite deplorable on this occasion if the Treasury were to try and bounce measures on the Cabinet, as has happened in the past. In July, after we'd been through an agonising process and agreed on a billion's worth of cuts, which I may say I argued to be quite unwarranted at that time, and then the Treasury came back with a proposal for another billion, another deflationary billion in the form of a national insurance contribution increase. We had 24 hours notice of that. We were confronted with what was in effect a fait accompli. So I do hope, Prime Minister, on this occasion we're not treated in that fashion.
I think we've had quite enough of this kind of thing. After all, those of us who are on the Economic Committee have known about the application of the IMF for some time, but those who are not on it have not had the slightest opportunity to discuss it. And indeed, we've had the humiliating spectacle at the Labour Party conference only 4 weeks or so ago of ministers actually being driven to walk around the corridors of the hall asking journalists what was going on.
Well, what I would like to know is when the Cabinet can discuss its package.
Well, subject to the views of the Prime Minister, I imagine that we'd do this thing the way we normally do these things, that's to say when we're clearer in our own minds what would be appropriate and getting closer to the IMF's position, that the general strategy would be decided in the Economic Committee and that the conclusions of that committee would then be brought back to the Cabinet for your consideration and, I would hope, approval.
Well, with respect, Prime Minister, this may have been the traditional matter of traditional way of dealing with these affairs, but it's inconceivable we can discuss this way on this occasion. The Chancellor is now proposing that these fundamental decisions are taken inside the Economic Strategy Committee, but half the Cabinet are not members of that committee, including myself.
I'm not trying to bounce anything through the Cabinet or anywhere else, but the fact is that it seems likely that in the end we shall be dealing with the possibility of tax increases, and traditionally tax increases have not been discussed in the full Cabinet for obvious reasons. It's also likely that we're going to have to be dealing with the delicate nature of our negotiating position with the International Monetary Fund, and that sort of thing has traditionally been handled previously by a Cabinet Committee, but I'm happy to do it anyway, which seems sensible.
Really, in some ways, it's now starting to look as if the Treasury is putting the argument in the mouth of the IMF and then saying these are the conditions which we have to accept. It's really not on.
It's obviously absolutely essential to us that we're not pushed by the IMF or anyone else into policies that are against our own long-term interests. So I think it's essential that every member of the Cabinet should be given a chance to air his views on this matter, and I undertake that I'll conduct the discussions in that sense.
For 3 weeks, the Chancellor and the Treasury continued with IMF officials their detailed examination of the forecasts. The IMF in Washington is a kind of mutual help club for its member governments. Britain was asking for the maximum loan permitted. Before agreeing, the fund required a large cut in the planned government deficit, the public sector borrowing requirement. The IMF accepted one easy saving, the sale of some shares in BP, British Petroleum. Harold Lever flew to Washington to tell the American government, the IMF's most powerful member, the political risks in squeezing us too hard. But the Americans felt that the British government must reduce its deficit by cutting public spending.
Well, we're now in a position to discuss the IMF drawing. I think it will be most convenient if the Chancellor gives us the present position.
Well, we've made very substantial progress, both in our own minds and in the parallel discussions with the IMF, since we last discussed this. And our own much maligned forecasts have indeed been refined. My understanding of the IMF's position is that they would like to see a fiscal adjustment by a combination of expenditure cuts and or some element of tax increase over the next 2 years of the order of $2 billion next year and something slightly larger, perhaps $3 billion the year after.
But this means that for 2 years the IMF will take complete control over our economic policy. That's unacceptable.
Let's just take this one step at a time. Let's concentrate for the moment on the first year.
Well, Prime Minister, I'm not sheltering behind the IMF. I'm not putting to you what the IMF wants or what the IMF is demanding. Or what they think is reasonable conditions before they make us a loan. I'm attempting to describe is, and what I'm working for, is what I believe is the right economic prescription for this country. And my own preference is that we should do it by some combination like bringing in the £500 million sale of the BP shares, to which we're already agreed in principle. And adding to that whatever is required, something perhaps $1 billion of direct expenditure cuts. And I think that broadly somewhere between the IMF's position and ours is a position which is not entirely unreasonable as a basis for continuing discussion. And I might say that negotiations with the IMF would be easier if we could indicate broadly that this was the sort of thing which would be acceptable to the Cabinet.
Well, we've heard the Treasury's view, and of course, in this sort of situation, it's one of the most important that we have to consider. But I have promised that the whole Cabinet shall be allowed to air its views on this thing, and it's absolutely right that it should do so. I think the Foreign Secretary should be the first to tell us his views.
Thank you, Prime Minister. I think what we have to consider most seriously as a Cabinet this morning is what conceivable case we're going to be able to make to the country, to the party, and indeed to ourselves for the sort of cuts which are being proposed by the Treasury. Now, it's not entirely clear to me exactly what volume of public expenditure cut the Treasury, or the fund, is proposing. I don't think it's clear from the Treasury paper, and it's not entirely clear from what the Chancellor has said this morning. What is abundantly clear to me is that there is no economic case whatsoever for further deflation at this time. And I would like to deal with the economic arguments first. Now, first, there's the argument about resources, that we need to shift resources into industry, into manufacture. But I don't think anybody can possibly seriously argue that we have a resource problem in this country at the moment with 1.25 million people already unemployed. Secondly, there's a technical argument about how to sell gilts and finance the public sector borrowing requirement. And I must say that along with many economic commentators and experts, I'm exceedingly skeptical about this argument. Now, the third economic argument we usually hear on these occasions is about the balance of payments. And this, I think, is the first economic crisis where public expenditure cuts have been demanded by the Treasury since the war. This is a record because this is the first time when there has been no balance of payments argument. Now, fourthly, there is the argument about our industrial strategy. And I must say again that I find it very hard to believe that investors are going to invest in British manufacturing industry with a growth prospect already as dismal as for 1.5% next year, with unemployment probably as high as 1.75 million next year. And I simply do not believe that interest rates are the crucial factor determining investment. If there is no final demand, people will not invest. Now, finally, there is the economic effect on the social contract of what is being proposed, and I needn't dwell on this. Unemployment up further, rents up, the housing program cut again. What do we imagine is going to be the effect on the social contract? It must be plainly disastrous. Now, we might be able to sell it to Jack Jones, but I don't think that the public sector, I don't think there's a chance that the public sector trade unions will enter into a stage three pay agreement if we pile cut, expenditure cut upon expenditure cut in this fashion. And secondly, what about the party? The party at the moment, the party in Parliament, is in a state of sullen acquiescence, but I don't think that they're going to take very much more. And on the right of the party, I'm not simply talking about the Tribune Group and the left, on the right of the party, there is a good deal of, great deal of reluctance, I think, to enter into yet another Treasury package. So on both grounds, on the political and on the economic, I would contend that there is no case whatsoever for further deflation of the economy at this time.
John to the Duchy.
The Foreign Secretary has made a powerful speech with which I fully agree. A further dose of deflation at this point really is what we need at all. In addition to the 2.5 billion cuts we've already suffered in February and July, it's the precise opposite of what this economy need now. All the economic indicators point to a year of low growth or no growth at all next year. To add to this by further deflating demand at this point would be madness. Let's be clear, I'm not defending the current levels of public expenditure. I'm prepared to look at a carefully prepared expenditure revision programme, provided it can be done without deflation. But if there are cuts, if there are cuts in public expenditure, it must be balanced by income tax cut, too, so that there should be no further deflation.
Well, it's all very well for the Chancellor of the Duchy and the Foreign Secretary to strike these heroic postures, but there's been a great deal of criticism of the fact that interest rates in this country are now too high and that this is affecting industrial investment and house mortgages and everything else. There is only one way in which interest rates are going to be reduced, and that's by reducing our deficit and our borrowing requirement. And it's for that reason that I am proposing the sort of package which we're presently negotiating with the International Monetary Fund.
Vice Secretary?
Prime Minister, I would like to express my agreement with what the Foreign Secretary has said and what the Chancellor of the Duchy has said. I think there's no case for further deflation now with unemployment at its present levels. And I find it unacceptable and rather intolerable the way public spending of all kinds is being pilloried at present. Of course there's waste, particularly in local government, which we can cut away. But public spending really is the essence of the type of social democracy most of us have been fighting all our lives for.
I shall call some of the spending ministers, and perhaps we can bear in mind some of the direct consequences of any cuts that have to be made. First, we could start with the Social Services Secretary.
Thank you, Prime Minister. My department is considering a series of options which have been put forward by the Treasury. We received the circular last week, and it covers a whole range of cuts in social benefits affecting unemployment, pensions, prescription charges, sickness benefits, and it really is an intolerable high level. If the want to proceed with cuts on this scale, then it would certainly need legislation in the House of Commons, and I seriously doubt whether we would get this through. Let me give you an example. If one starts cutting into short-term benefits, then this will mean amending the Social Security Act of 1975, and if not amending it, then we possibly even have to bring in a new bill.
Prime Minister, I think we're missing the main point here, which is that we've got to face the fact that more and more people think it's wrong that virtually the whole burden of the national sacrifice is being carried by people who are in work, while we're fully protecting against inflation those who are not in work. And there's widespread resentment about this, and resentment amongst our own people as well. And if we're going to get this deficit down to some acceptable level, we've got to find a way of reducing the cash burden of high unemployment and other benefits.
Well, Hannes, to examine what would happen to the trade unions. Would they accept this? What would happen to the social contract? And what would happen inside the Parliamentary Labour Party? Already we have a revolt on our hands against measures we took in July this year.
The Chancellor talks about the cash burden of high unemployment. You may remember that I've sent around to some of you the 1931 Cabinet minutes, and if you look in there, and I'm sure you probably read those, the fact is that the very arguments which we're now starting to hear about the necessity to cut social benefits were happening at that moment as well. Back they went then at that time again to this argument about the cash burden of high unemployment, until finally that government was wrecked on the rock of cutting unemployment benefit at that time. You know that my father was a member of that cabinet, and he voted at the end in the wrong way. I assure you that I'm not going to go along that road. Indeed, at the end, he said that he regretted what he had done.
Well, I must say, I've looked at some of the things, and I've got the greatest respect for the memory of the Energy Secretary's father, the late Lord Stansgate, but with all respect to him, I think the situation's totally different, absolutely different politically. But we've got no prospect, I hope, at any rate, of a split in this cabinet.
It's not the political situation.
I've got no coalition with
great,
coming up.
With great respect, Prime Minister, it's not the political situation. Of course, you may have the will of the movement to try and back you, but we are coming back to the point of trying to penalise those people out of work.
The situation is totally different. The social security situation is different. Finally, I may say, I am not Ramsay MacDonald.
I have some sympathy, I must say, with the Chancellor's view on the overlap problem, but it is, in my view, impractical to suddenly turn round to old age pensioners and say, look, chaps, times are bad now, we're going to cut you back. This really is intolerable, and I don't think it can be accepted. Of course we've misjudged our financial position, and it's very serious, but the only solution here is growth, and that is a solution that parallels the instincts of every other civilised country.
I fail to see how the Chancellor is going to be able to defend the proposals he has put before us. I think it's now apparent that there is a consensus growing up, both inside this cabinet and among economic opinion outside the cabinet, that another dose of massive deflation would be disastrous for this country. We have all seen the document circulated to us by the Chancellor, and you will observe that my department is probably highest on the list for the onslaught on its expenditure levels. One of the targets of the Chancellor is the level of our building programme. We already have a construction industry which has unemployment reaching the level of about 200,000. Should we engage in further cuts, then we would have an almost moribund construction industry and probably no industry left at all when we sought to begin to expand again.
The volume of expenditure cuts involved there, Prime Minister, is still, in my view, far too high.
With the greatest respect to my colleagues, Prime Minister, they can't have it both ways. I think they need to consider what will happen if we don't get the loan, roughly on the terms that we're negotiating at the moment. It's absolutely clear, nobody can deny it, that there would then be a most massive crisis of confidence in sterling. The exchange rate would go for a Burton, it would make the slide that we've seen this year already seem as nothing. And that would have the direct consequences of higher interest rates, higher prices, and lower employment. So that it's precisely the opposite of what they're suggesting.
Perhaps we cannot turn our minds completely away from the confidence question. Something has to be done for confidence. So I would suggest that the Chancellor might explore with the IMF the possibility of us looking for cuts of, say, £500 million, and as far as possible of a non-deflationary kind, and we can add to that the £500 million reduction in the public sector borrowing requirement, which will result from our sale of the BP stock, and that's it. And we should tell them that that's it. And we should take the line which the Prime Minister took very effectively, if I may say so, in his Panorama broadcast. And we should tell the Germans and the Americans the limits of what we can do. And we should tell the IMF the limits of what we can do. And if we do that, I am convinced that the IMF will grant us the loan on our terms.
Well, I see that it's pretty well 1 o'clock. And if we sit late, as everybody knows, the press immediately jumps to the conclusion that there's an enormous cabinet crisis. So I think we better stop and put off the rest of the discussion until next Thursday. I must say the discussion so far I've found very interesting and rather disturbing. I think that we've got a certain amount of discussion to do. We must see what Len Murray and the TUC have to say about it. I think that the Chancellor will want to go back to the IMF.
Out of the cabinet of 24 ministers, only Reg Prentice and Edmund Dell, neither represented in this programme, supported the Chancellor's tough line.
Inside British Politics, P889/5, for transmission of the 10th, 777, Part 2, Take 1.
I should like to begin this morning by reminding Cabinet of the confidentiality of these proceedings. I find it very disconcerting, to say the least, to wake up morning after morning and find blow-by-blow accounts of what we've been saying here in the newspapers. There are very good practical reasons for the doctrine of collective responsibility. We can't have a rational discussion here if all this stuff's leaking out. And I must say, I rather resent what I take to be an attempt to drive a wedge between me and the Chancellor. I've every confidence in the Chancellor. We've got to be able to trust each other sufficiently to have a decent discussion without feeling that it's going outside the walls of this room all the time.
The journalists continue their reconstruction of the Cabinet arguments.
I would like to move on rather quickly to whether there is an alternative strategy altogether. And we ought to hear the Energy Secretary at this point.
Thank you, Prime Minister. In starting off and presenting the alternative strategy, the fact is that we face now a very gloomy situation. By 1978, we could have 2 million unemployed in this country. We'll have further falls in living standards. And far worse, there is no real chance of the industrial recovery which we all want. And in those circumstances, I think then we have to look at what we get for the IMF loan, the loan that we are now talking about. For the $2 billion which we are likely to get this year from the IMF, we'll have to pay off last May's standby loan. And so we don't get very much out of it. And worst of all, we surrender our right to exchange controls to defend the pound. We surrender our right to use import controls to protect industry. And we surrender our right to reflate the economy and reduce unemployment.
Are you actually proposing that we don't apply for the IMF loan at all, that we just disregard it, we don't need a loan?
Well, I thought that the whole point of the Cabinet meetings was that we were discussing not just the terms of applying for the loan, but what the strategy was.
But your strategy is to ignore the loan altogether, well, is it? And
well,
I not to apply and well, not to, we don't need the loan, is that it?
The Prime Minister said that we should have a discussion on strategy. I thought that that was open, Prime Minister, to discussion at the moment.
But this is cloud cuckoo land. I mean, where in your scheme of things are we going to get the finance to repay the immediate loans that are due, or indeed to finance our immediate prospective deficit?
Well, Chancellor, we are discussing whether we should accept these loans or whether we should accept an alternative strategy which would give us the sort of growth in our economy in order to be able to escape from the dilemmas that we are in. The fact is that the Labour Party is pledged to full employment, and that is the most crucial issue, and what we want to see is import controls over manufactured goods in order to protect jobs. We also need exchange controls to protect the pound, and we really must go ahead and move into a position where the industrial strategy starts to bite. As you know, we've had talks with the TUC, and Labour Party conference has been urging us to move towards this sort of strategy. And that entails planning agreements with industry to ensure proper investment and in the proper places as well, and vigorous use of the National Enterprise Board, much more than we've been doing so far, and of course an adoption of a proper system of price controls. Now, if we accept the Chancellor's proposals, we shall be condemning Britain to high unemployment for a long period of time to come. But I am arguing very clearly for an alternative strategy that would return us towards full employment in this country. And I can see no other way than adopting the whole of the alternative strategy that I've put forward.
Prime Minister, it's never been clear to me how the seed strategists propose to revitalise British industry. It's always seemed to me that that sort of control over imports is in fact featherbedding, perpetuating the sort of difficulties that we're trying to get over with our other policies.
Environment Secretary.
Thank you, Prime Minister. I want to throw my support behind what the Energy Secretary has said. Some of you will no doubt recall that I was at one time opposed to the use of import controls. But I believed at that time that the threat of enormous oil price increases had a heavy impact not only on us, but also on the whole of the rest of the world. That it would therefore have been open to our competitors and our trading partners to condemn us and to take retaliatory action if we attempted to solve our problems at their expense. That situation no longer exists. We have seen most of the stronger industrial nations succeed in coping with the consequences of the oil price increase. Only Britain and also Italy still face a long-term crisis, and their problem is shown to be unique. Therefore, in those circumstances, this country is qualified under the rules of the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade to take immediate action to deal with the crisis we face. And I am absolutely certain that we would receive, if not the sympathy, then at any rate the acquiescence of our competitors and our trading partners. What I am suggesting is that we should have 2 years, a period of approximately 2 years, of really firm control over our imports in order to get our balance of payments into a situation in which we can begin the regeneration of British industry. I don't argue that it can be achieved in that 2 years, merely that it will provide the launching pad as we wait for the arrival of the oil revenues. I concede that a policy of even temporary import controls could very well lead to an inflationary effect as a result of shutting out foreign goods normally on our markets. But I contend that this need not necessarily be anything like as serious as has been suggested in some quarters, because I believe that with a grossly underused industrial capacity in this country, it will be only a short period before our own domestic producers are able to fill very much of the shortfall. If there is to be a cut in the borrowing requirement, that is the government deficit, I believe very strongly that this must be achieved by direct taxes, increases in direct taxation, and not by the imposition of deflationary cuts in public expenditure, which will only increase our unemployment figure. May I conclude by saying that I put this case to you because I believe passionately in the importance of the sovereignty and independence of Britain, and I do not believe that one can contribute to that in any way by plunging us further and further into debt.
Well, the Environment Secretary has made a clever argument, one that hangs a great deal better, in my view, together than the speech we've heard from the Secretary of State for Energy today. But like him, he has dangerously underestimated the damage the alternative strategy would do to our international trading relations. It would almost certainly mean the abandonment of all our hopes, Prime Minister, for the sterling safety net. Why should countries, who we are about to directly damage, help us solve our problems of the pound? If this government has any future, indeed, it must lie, surely, in increasing international cooperation, not in some form of individual anarchy.
I think we have two alternative strategies, one from the Energy Secretary and one from the Environment Secretary. And in neither way am I convinced that we can guarantee that there will be no cuts in public expenditure.
You can't artificially impose a barricade and build socialism behind it. And we've got to get the economy right first and get our manufacturers competing in the world before we can build socialism.
I think, Prime Minister, that at least the Environment Secretary's presentation of the alternative strategy had an internal logic that was lacking from Tony Benn's presentation of it. Because an internal strategy, and we need to be clear about this, that has any chance of working, would require a deflation of domestic demand to keep prices under control.
and really quite severe disruption of production and demand and employment, and we've got to face that fact. And I think that we were unfortunately deflected from our July course because our monetary policy got out of control during the summer, and that what we're now proposing is a package to get us back onto that course. And to put all that at risk with this huge leap into the dark with alternative strategy would be a step that would absolutely not be justified either by our present position or by our future prospects.
Well, I think if I get the sense of the cabinet correctly, the majority doesn't find the alternative of general import controls a very satisfactory alternative to what we might otherwise have to do. On the other hand, if we're going to consider what the next step is to be, I think we should have another more detailed look, perhaps, at what ways we can think of to bring down our borrowing requirement, which are not actually expenditure cuts, which we all would find very painful.
If the cabinet is looking for painless cuts, well, on public expenditure, well, I can come up with them. And I've already, I think, suggested to you, Prime Minister, a number of ways, quite apart from BP, which I think the IMF will accept. We could save at least 200 millions on export credits. They are at the moment, as you know, financed by the Treasury, but there's absolutely no reason why they should be. Just as I was able to persuade the building societies to fill the gap left by the local authorities on mortgages, so I am sure we could get the commercial banks to take on export credits. It's, as you like, it's a painless way of fiddling the PSBR, and these blood merchants of the IMF, that's apparently what they want to see us do. And why shouldn't we do it in a painless way?
We need to be absolutely clear in our minds that whatever figure we finally decide and agree with the IMF for the fiscal adjustment, that's got to be done in real cuts and not gimmicks. And I agree with the IMF that that's what's required, because part of what we're doing is to reduce the amount of the nation's output which is preempted by the public sector.
Now, what the Chancellor has just said absolutely confirms my very worst suspicions, because we started out by being told that the problem was the public sector borrowing requirement, that it was too high and that it ought to be diminished. Now we're being told that this isn't the IMF's concern at all, but what they want to do is to slash into our expenditure programs, into our social expenditure programs. This, it seems, is what the Treasury wants to do. And this is where I would continue to argue that we should stand firm and stand on our own judgment and not on other people's judgment of what is good for our economy and for our people.
Well, I don't think anybody supposes we're going to let the IMF push us around. We've got to make our own judgment about it. And what's more, we've got to make it pretty quickly now. Time's running out on us. I think it's time for a decision, and I suggest that we try and come to one tomorrow.
Mr. Callaghan had been prodded by visits from both the United States Treasury Secretary and the Managing Director of the IMF. At a European summit in The Hague that week, Mr. Callaghan had talked with Helmut Schmidt, the West German Chancellor, about the loan and about the safety net for sterling he hoped to arrange. This safety net was to be provided by countries with large reserves who would help Britain out if foreign holders of sterling started a run on the pound. The Foreign Secretary, Anthony Crosland, sat next to Mr. Callaghan on the flight back from the summit, and as a result of what he learned then, called together some of his close allies for what was to prove a crucial meeting, one of many discussions on tactics that went on behind the scenes.
I managed to have a word or two with Jim on the plane coming back from The Hague last night. He didn't make anything perfectly clear, and there were a lot of officials hanging around, and everybody was relaxing a bit after the summit. But I must say, I got the impression that he's going to be on the Chancellor's side cabinet tomorrow.
Well, why would you do that? Well, he's against deflation.
Well, I think his instincts are against it, as ours have been, indeed, as ours very strongly remain. But he had a private chat with Helmut Schmidt in The Hague, and I think he's been on the phone to Washington a good deal. And I suspect the truth of the matter may be that the Americans and the Germans are being rather insistent that we must satisfy the IMF, and that he, as Prime Minister, is conscious of the importance of this, not only
in order to obtain the IMF loan, although that's pretty important, but because also riding on this negotiation is the safety net for the sterling balances, and that's even more important. So I can see that, Jim, after all, the sterling balances are, that's his thing. He was a, he floated this on Panorama. It's been his pet project. So I can see that he would attach a great deal of importance to that aspect of it.
We were facing quite a political problem here, aren't we?
Well, my instincts are still against it. I'd be most reluctant to have to support the Chancellor. I mean, I suspect that we're going to be asked for $1 billion in cuts, plus the 500 million BP. I still think it's too much.
We could well be in a majority. I mean, the left are going to back us. David Ennals will back us. I mean, the only one who's moved over so far in the cabinet is Bill Rogers.
Yes. Now, here's Harold.
Harold Lever was the other minister invited to join Mr. Crosland. He arrived straight from a talk with the Chancellor. Mr. Lever had been against public spending cuts solely because he believed they would deflate, that is, depress, the economy too much. But he felt a cut in income tax would give the economy a boost. Mr. Lever had put this to the Chancellor and brought a copy of the proposal with him.
There's a copy here for you. Just let me explain. But he has agreed that to fully offset any measure of deflation that we have now got in these cuts, in income tax reduction in the budget. Now, it's vitally important. The cuts don't come into effect, of course, until April, but the budget's at the same time. There'll be no deflationary impact.
All he says is he may cut income taxes.
My dear,
if he secures it, he will try and pay, that he can get out of it. If the borrowing requirement is too high next spring, he can get out of it.
You can't really expect the Chancellor to tie himself down in categorical black and white terms, but I have received assurances...
He doesn't tie himself down to anything.
...that he... Well, I think if you look at that very closely, you can't expect a Chancellor to go further than that.
But my position has been, and my position still is, that there are no grounds whatsoever for further cuts in social programs. These are programs which affect ordinary people's lives, and I'm simply against them being cut on the say-so of the IMF for these very spurious arguments that are advanced.
But surely you can't be in a position of just defending the current levels of public expenditure, come what may.
The difference, I think, between us is that we're both agreed in our opposition to deflation, but we remain firm in our opposition to cuts in social programmes.
Well, that's much more important to us. I mean, it's public spending which matters to us at Social Democrats, not giving away income tax cuts. We might as well have the Tories in for that.
But really, what clearly matters in this is, surely, is the degree of deflation which is being imposed on the economy. I'm not here at any time just to defend present levels of public expenditure. I'm afraid I've given my word to Dennis. If you aren't prepared to support me, well, there we are.
Mr. Lever left to follow Bill Rogers into the Healey camp. But Crosland and Hattersley, along with Ennals, Benn and Shaw, and other ministers not represented in this programme, were still firm in their opposition to Mr. Healey's package. There were enough of them to have a real chance of a majority in the next day's cabinet.
We do have to consider very seriously the consequences of the possibility that we might find a majority on our side.
And you've won the argument so far. You humiliated Dennis in the argument over cabinet on the economic case.
I think it is true that we have won the intellectual argument, but I think we must think through very carefully the consequences of our finding ourselves in a majority in cabinet tomorrow against the Prime Minister and against the Chancellor. That would be a most serious situation for the government.
The House of Commons sat late, and the Foreign Secretary considered what to do. Eventually, he called into the Prime Minister's room. Only the two men present know what was said at that meeting. What the eight journalists can reconstruct is what happened in Cabinet the next morning.
Well, the Cabinet now has before it the Chancellor's proposal that we should adopt a package of £1.5 billion. That's £1 billion in expenditure cuts and £500 million on the sale of British Petroleum shares. We understand that this would be agreeable to the IMF, and we now have to decide what to do. I've listened very carefully and with great interest to what everyone said, and I hope you'll all agree that everybody's had a very fair crack of the whip during the last four or five cabinet meetings. I don't want to impose my own views on the cabinet, but I think the time's come for me to say what I think my position is about all this. It seems to me that, from what we've said, it's perfectly clear that none of us wants deflation in any kind. We're all extremely concerned about unemployment. None of us wants expenditure cuts, which may be difficult to restore when the economy grows again. And I'd certainly, for my own part, hope that we got rid of the last of the cuts that we were going to do in the first round in July, for political reasons as much as anything else. But we've got to live in the real world. We've got to live in the real world. We need the IMF loan. If we don't get the IMF loan, we've got to face confidence outside and an exchange rate which might go down even further and land us into even worse problems with our inflation rate. We also need the safety net for sterling, and the safety net and the IMF loan go together. Now, I've spent a good deal of time talking on the telephone to President Ford. We've been in touch with President Carter and his economic advisers. We know what they think. I've talked a lot to Chancellor Schmidt at The Hague last weekend and on the telephone constantly. And I'm absolutely convinced, and you just have, I'm afraid, to take my word for this, that the Americans and the Germans wouldn't accept less than what the Chancellor is now proposing as their terms for letting the IMF loan go forward and approving a safety net. My own judgment is that these are the minimum terms that they will accept, and I must say that I think they're about the maximum terms that we can reasonably ask the party to accept. I think we've got very little room for manoeuvre, and so I reluctantly come to the conclusion that we must recommend that the Chancellor's proposals should be accepted. Foreign Secretary.
I'm totally unconvinced still by the economic case for cuts on this scale. And my economic judgment is not affected, Prime Minister, by what you've just said. But what you have just said to the Cabinet does, I think, significantly alter the situation. And my political judgment now is that we must back your political judgment. If it were to leak from this room that you and the Chancellor had been overruled on this issue, the effect on the pound is unimaginable. The effect on the effect on confidence in the Parliamentary Labour Party would be just as serious. The survival of the government might perhaps be in doubt, and on that basis, you have my support.
I share the Foreign Secretary's concern about this measure of deflation we're asked to accept, but I've asked myself a number of questions. Do we have to have a deal with the IMF? The Prime Minister has quite clearly stated we do have to. Do we have to cut public expenditure? Yes, I do think we do so. The present level of public expenditure is based on an expectation of economic growth that the economy has not materialized. We have to be honest and tell people that it just cannot keep the present levels at this moment. But does that mean we have to go into deflation? Certainly not, in my view. I support the cuts, and I support the IMF application. But I hope for my part, very sincerely, that the Chancellor will correct the deflation with income tax reductions when he comes to the budget.
Well, of course, Prime Minister, if when I make my budget judgment next year, I think that there is room for tax cuts within our new forecast for the deficit. And incidentally, if by that time, as I hope, we've got a satisfactory agreement with the TUC and CBI on the next pay round, then of course I would like to make use of that margin to reduce the levels of income tax which presently prevail.
Prime Minister, I still find intolerable the suggestions being put forward by the Chancellor of the Exchequer about tax cuts. We need to stimulus the economy now, and the way we ought to do it as Social Democrats is via public spending, not via tax relief to the better off. However, like the Foreign Secretary, I believe we ought to listen to and respect your political judgment. So with considerable misgivings and some apprehension, I support you.
Social services.
Well, Prime Minister, I agree with a lot of what the Prime Secretary has said, but quite clearly since the last meeting there's been a sea change in the view of the Cabinet, and I respect the views of my colleagues. Some opinions did surprise me, but I understand this.
I'd just like to say if this policy fails, the only other policy left is the alternative strategy.
This policy isn't going to fail. The total that we're agreeing is the right total. I suspect that some of you thought it was politically unacceptable and that some of you thought at the beginning that the IMF wouldn't accept it. But they have, and I'm extremely pleased that they have.
Well, in that case, I take it that we're agreed that we should accept the proposal made by the Chancellor for £1.5 billion, £1 billion expenditure cuts, £500 million sale of BP. Mm-hmm. What remains now, of course, is even more painful than the discussions we've been having so far, and that's exactly where these cuts are going to fall. That's going to take us two or three more cabinets, and I don't think any of us are going to like it very much. I propose that we should adopt much the same programme as we have over the last few cabinets. Everybody will have a chance to say their piece and to make their objection. And on that basis, I hope we can carry a united cabinet through the second half of this exercise.
The journalists stop here, but the real story continues. Mr. Callaghan achieved his objective. For three more full meetings, ministers argued over cuts, but they all united behind the final package. On December the 15th, Mr. Healy announced the agreed terms. £500 million from the sale of BP shares, £100 million from refinancing export credits. But there were also cuts in public expenditure, £160 million from stopping food subsidies, and almost £200 million off roads, schools, hospitals. On the 10th of January, the IMF paid the first £1.6 billion of the loan, and the safety arrangement for sterling was agreed. You may be wondering how accurate that reconstruction really was. As a Labour MP listening to the gossip in the lobbies, I've not heard any minister deny its accuracy. But you don't have to take my word for it. It happens that one cabinet minister resigned a little while after the cabinet discussions and was free to say what he thought in a radio interview on London Broadcasting the morning after the programme was first shown. He was asked, did he think the journalists got it right?
Well, I think that they did a very good job, given the limits they were working under. Over 20 hours of cabinet discussion being condensed into less than 1 hour of broadcasting time. And I think within the limitations of time, they did it very well.